Thank you and welcome to Georgia Championship Wrestling. The opening match in the ring from Atlanta, Georgia, 235 pounds. Here's Ken Timbs. Ken Timbs. His opponent, ladies and gentlemen, from Tampa, Florida, at 230 pounds, meet Brian Blair. Brian Blair, your referee, George Scott Jr.
At ringside, Gordon Soley here. Brian Blair in the light blue trunks going up against Ken Timbs. Beautiful. Go behind. High waisted takedown by Ken Timbs and Blair. A nice escape. Both men back on their feet once again. Collar and elbow. Ken Timbs now with a side headlock on Brian Blair. And it's Blair dropping to the canvas this time. Coming off. Beautiful shoulder smash. Caught Timbs in the chest into a salto. Well-executed salto by Brian Blair, but Timbs has his foot over the ropes, and so consequently the referee calls for the break. Front chancery now by Brian Blair has Timbs in trouble once again. Blair, by the way, as you heard, from Tampa, Florida, went to the University of Louisville. By the way, while at Louisville, maintained a 3.1 grade average, which made him an honor student, has his B.S. degree in political science. And Timbs now, using the forearm and the back of the elbow very effectively. Blair gets him back into the ring ropes. The referee calls for the break. And you can hear the crowd picking up the chant now, "Go, Brian, go." Brian Blair, a very popular young competitor. And a very determined Ken Timbs. Ken and his brother are quite a tag team combination, Ken and Ed Timbs. Blair, by the way, was All-State in football, most valuable wrestler, 3 years in high school. Back into the ring ropes now, the referee calling for the break. Timbs using that shoulder very effectively on the break. Reversal by Blair that time as Timbs back to the canvas. All right, Blair keeping a front chancery now. Hooks, underhooks the arm into a takedown. Come on, Brian! Timbs, by the way, in amateur sports, was in track, basketball, football, and Golden Glove boxing. And does a lot of weightlifting. Of course, he's always been competitive on a one-to-one basis. And wrestling, of course, number one love with him. Both men backing away now. Referee watching him carefully. One fall, 10-minute time limit on this match. Duck under, go behind. Waistful takedown by Blair once again. Timbs is a former law enforcement officer. All right, the referee, they're into the ropes, and the referee calls for the break. Notice the way Blair had a good waist lock on his man. Timbs adjusting those knee pads now moves in once again. Knees and elbows, of course, suffer a lot in wrestling because of the canvas itself. Blair caught him. Airplane spin by Brian Blair. And a reverse power slam using his back and full pressure down. A count of three, and an outstanding victory for Brian Blair. Hi, and welcome to Georgia Championship Wrestling. I'm Gordon Soley, your host, and I can assure you that you're seeing a brand new era in professional wrestling beginning here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. In the near future, we'll be bringing you top international stars from all over the world who will be competing here. Also, of course, we're going to be hopefully hearing and seeing in person the president of the NWA, Jim Crockett, on several issues concerning professional wrestling the worldwide. So be watching for that in the very, very near future. During this next hour, we're going to be hearing from the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. Also, Jerry Oates will be seeing in action. The Anderson brothers, Tommy Wildfire, Rich, and many, many more, including Bruno Sammartino Jr. So we do have a lot of excitement in store for you during the next hour. By all means, do stay tuned. And we will be back to watch the great Kabuki in action right after we pause for these words. Playboy Gary Hart has joined me here, and I wanted to ask him some rather specific questions regarding the great Kabuki. First of all, I think it's interesting to note that this man has mastered American catch-can wrestling as well as many other Asiatic forms of hand-to-hand combat.
Basically, the man is a master of gung fu, which there are four forms. I want everyone to understand, you can develop many parts of your body, but in gung fu or any of the martial arts, the center of the body is the object, because you cannot, the spleen, the sternum, and under the arm, you cannot develop. And today, you will see him as the snake, and you will know for sure that Kabuki's everything I've told you he is and more.
It's rather unusual for a man to give you an example of what you're going to see in action, but that's what we're going to see right now, the great Kabuki in action against Gerald Finley. We're waiting now for the bell to ring, and it is Gary Hart leading the way for the great Kabuki to step into the ring. Here you see Kabuki on the right. Now, Kabuki will wear a different form of face paint. Really, for every match. He has been scarred at one point in his career when he was shoved into a bed of hot coals, and consequently he wears the face makeup, I guess is the only way you could really phrase it, but an exceptionally dangerous man, and we of course heard him talk today about gung fu and the fact that he will be bringing out the snake very... And there's that mysterious green fog again by Kabuki. And most unusual thing, Gerald Finley, who is an outstanding athlete and a tremendous competitor. Finley, now there you see... notice the formation of the arms and the hands. And very definitely puts you... in mind of a snake, more particularly of a cobra. Ooh, a chop, and it is Finley firing back. Excellent right forearm to the chest. And again, Kabuki. And excellent defensive posture. It'll be very, very difficult to cross. Ah, but a good single leg pickup. Tried for a back leg trip, but Kabuki blocked it very nicely and drove a chop into the throat of Gerald Finley. Caught him. That would be a crane-like movement. So he is combining very quickly the forms of gung fu with American catch-a-sketch-can wrestling. Ooh, and Finley hurtled through those ropes. Had to catch that steel ring post. And Finley caught, and Finley back on his feet, however. However, that has taken its toll on him, Finley. Back a double chop to either side of the neck by Kabuki. Kabuki catches him in the throat. And Finley has a world of problems going, but Finley back a side headlock. It's a good service match by Gerald Finley. And as Finley charged in again, it was Kabuki with the crane kung fu. Gung fu, rather. Finley caught on either side. And this is another thing, of course, about the Asians and the Orientals. They generally know all of the pressure points. Down. He came down directly on Finley off that second rope and had his man in a lot of trouble there. And now being... if you will, in a sense, almost herded here by Playboy Gary Hart. And there you see Kabuki and the strange formation of the fingers and the hands. Of course, so many of your Asiatics do have hands that show the years and years and years of constant usage of those hands in dealing lethal kind of blows. I want to take a moment right now to talk to the great Mephisto, Mr. Ray Stevens, and Thor Kamata. Here are three men that we saw very obviously have been promised a considerable sum of money to accomplish certain things.
You know, I was just in the back talking to Superstar. I was talking to Superstar on the telephone. And he wanted to remind us that the time is drawing near. So the only thing I told the superstar, that Tommy Rich's time is drawing near. You know, it seems all you have to do is to go out and get yourself a mystery partner, like happened previously with Tommy Rich acquiring the services, like I said before, and I'll repeat again, of a genuine nut, and that is Dick Slater. So I, the great Mephisto, went ahead, and they have a quaint saying here in the United States, what is good for the goose is good for the gander. So I have acquired the services of a mystery partner, a great wrestler that will be the partner of Thor Kamata. You know, Mr. Ray Stevens here has a few select words to say about one Dick Slater.
Well, first of all, let me remind all of you, of course, that Championship Wrestling returns to the Omni here in Atlanta on Sunday, November 1st. And, of course, tomorrow afternoon, things get rolling in Huntington.
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, they put Dick Slater in that box, brought him out of here, and he's a maniac, a group. Like everybody knows, he belongs in the insane asylum someplace. Well, I'm going to tell you what, Dick Slater, I'm going to do you a favor, and I'm going to put you out of professional wrestling. And you know, Mephisto here and Kamata and his mystery partner, no matter what they do, I'm still going to get my part of the money, right. So I'm not worried about that.
And I might add that my mystery partner is not the mass superstar. And I'll tell you who he is.
Tomorrow night in Columbus, Ohio.
Ohio, we'll be there, and also Huntington, West Virginia. And I'll be more than happy to divulge the information who the mystery partner is. He signed an affidavit, the mystery partner, that he is not the mass superstar.
Thank you so very much. Take a moment now to talk to Nick Patrick. He was involved in the World Heavyweight Championship rematch recently between Dusty Rhodes and Ric Flair. And Nick, first of all, welcome to the program. But secondly, a rather heavy responsibility fell on your shoulders during that match.
Well, thank you very much, Gordon. What happened is the NWA always appoints two referees to watch over World Championship matches. And during the match, Ronnie West was the original referee. He was struck, he was knocked down. So I jumped in the ring and continued the match. During the match, Dusty had Ric Flair down close to the ropes. I dove in and I made the 1-2-3 count. When Dusty got up, I saw that Ric Flair had his feet on the ropes. So I told him to continue the match. Dusty thought that he had won. He went over, he had the belt in his hands. I was telling him to continue the match. When Ric Flair come to him, Dusty hit him with the belt, knocked him out. He was seriously injured. So I had no other choice but to disqualify Dusty Rhodes.
Well, that was certainly understandable. And I think, too, it's important to note that with the tremendous amount of noise that's going on, people shouting and cheering, with the height of excitement, with the adrenaline flowing like that, it's certainly understandable how somebody could misunderstand, particularly in a moment of jubilation, like thinking that he'd re-won the title.
Yes, sir. It was a very grueling match for both men, so I can realize where Dusty was confused, because he did hear the three count. However, Ric Flair's feet were on the ropes.
Which, of course, automatically calls for a break. And, of course, when they got back on their feet, as you said, Dusty had the belt. He thought he had won it. And when Ric Flair charged him, he really reacted instinctively, did he not?
Yes, sir. He struck him with the belt, and that was automatic grounds for disqualification.
And I might just point out that that's exactly what did happen. Now then, we do have some comments from the NWA World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Mr. Ric Flair, concerning the situation.
You know, I always referred to myself as the greatest from the time I was old enough to spell my name. From the time I was old enough to really know who I was and what I was doing. I've always called myself the greatest because I was the best athlete in high school. I had all the girls. I had the nicest clothes. I had all the luxuries that anybody of my talent and my ability deserved. Then I started professional wrestling. And a lot of people said, you think that that young kid is going to be the greatest wrestler of all time like he tells everybody he is? Well, look at me now. Still a young kid. In the prime of my life. Still wearing the finest clothes. And still knocking the women dead. Only one addition. I'm the world's heavyweight champion. And I didn't buy this. And this beautiful face and all these fine clothes didn't bring me this. solid wrestling ability. The ability to be a man above and beyond. 120% gut check brought me this. And I'm going to hang on to this for a long, long time. And those of you out there that doubt my durability or my lasting power, you just keep watching TV week in and week out. Because Ric Flair, the Nature Boy, woo, the living legend, is going to be the holder of this 10 pounds of gold for a long, long time. Only one thing left in life, and that's to hear them all say someday, Ric Flair was the greatest champion in the history of wrestling. Woo!
There's the bell, and it's Ed Timbs moving out against Jerry Oates very, very quickly. Oates, of course, from Columbus, Georgia, and an exceptionally popular competitor. But, boy, is he taking a beating right now at the hands of Ed Timbs. Ed Timbs is the brother of Ken Timbs we saw in action just a little bit ago. And, wow, Timbs brought him up. Beautiful body slam. Now with that elbow, but Oates rolled to one side. Oates has been taken off guard and somewhat unprepared for that attack, but is now trying to get it back together, and did so just then, and a good hard chopping right hand by Oates into a snap mirror by Oates. It takes Timbs back to the canvas. Timbs to the midsection, and Oates with a good forearm. Oates, a snap mare that takes Tim back to the canvas. All right. Tim's regaining his feet now. Oates keeping a front face lock on him. Oates now with a good high knee lift that put Tim's back to the canvas. Hiplock takedown into the side headlock now by Jerry Oates. The Oates brothers are indeed a potent tag team combination, but they wrestle enough in single matches that they have maintained their individuality. Good shoulder smash by Oates coming off the ropes. And Oates now, a bolo-like forearm that drops Timbs to the canvas once again. Young Raymond Engels here today celebrating his birthday along with a host of friends. Nice to have him along. And it is Oates now, a full body slam on Timbs. Oates again, variation of a front face lock on Timbs. Oates, tall, angular, extremely well-muscled. He's an exceptionally dangerous competitor, particularly when he goes to the air. Devastating drop kick. The collar and elbow, this time Timbs catching the advantage. Timbs holding a weight advantage on Oates. Those dark trunks, uh-uh. Catches Oates and could be using the fist here. That's the thing. And as the referee was momentarily diverted, it was Timbs using that right fist very effectively. Oates trying to bring him belly to back to play. Well executed. And it is Timbs now jarred and stunned by that suplex administered by Jerry Oates. Front face lock again by Oates. Oates could be classified in some areas as a very systematic competitor. However, just about the time you've got him figured out is when he'll surprise you with something else. Good backdrop. Timbs comes out of it before the count of three. Go behind and variation of a heel block takedown, and they're dangerously close to the ropes at this point in time. Oates Maintains the front face lock. Back on their feet once again. Timbs trying to the midsection, and Oates fires back and staggers Timbs. Caught him right in the side of the head that time. Into the turnbuckle. And the referee calling for the break, and Timbs, two shots with a shoulder into the midsection area. Slips to one side, and Timbs jams that shoulder into the turnbuckle, and Jerry Oates takes him to the... Goes into the spinning toe hold. Jerry Oates with a spinning toe hold on Ed Timbs, and Timbs very quickly concedes that's the very hold that brought Torrey Funk Jr. the World Heavyweight Championship when he defeated Gene Kaniski. And so the victor using the spinning toe hold is Jerry Oates.
Attention wrestling fans, Sunday, October 25th, 7:30, the Ohio Center, Columbus, Ohio. Brian St. John against Steve Bolus. Midget match, Cowboy Lang against Little Tokyo. Mr. Wrestling 2 against Big Jim Duggan. Steve Owen, Brian Blair against Ray Stevens and Tor Kamata. Michael Hayes, the original Freebird, against Terry Gordy, the former Freebird. And for the World's Heavyweight Championship, Nature Boy Ric Flair, champion, against Wildfire Tommy Rich. 7:30, the 25th. Don't miss it. Be there.
Here's your opportunity.
I want to take a moment right now to talk to two legendary competitors in professional wrestling. I'm referring, of course, to the Minnesota Wrecking Crew, Gene and Ole Anderson.
And we still have the World Tag Team Champions. We're the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. There's nobody. Ole and myself are going to take on all challenge. We don't care who they are. Wells, Rich, Wrestling 2, Ric Flair, we don't care. Because we're still the Minnesota Wrecking Crew, the world champions.
You know, we've been gone for a little while, and we've been traveling all over the world. We come back to Atlanta looking once more for the great talent that Atlanta always has. We're looking for some great competition. As he mentioned, Tommy Rich's and the Ric Flair's, the Wrestling Number 2's, or the Steve O's, or maybe even a couple of kids like we see up here in the ring, all trying to make a name for themselves. Remember this, we may not be fancy, we may not look pretty like Tommy Rich. We may not have some of the moves and the fancy clothes like a Ric Flair. We may not have all that flash and charisma like a Dusty Rhodes. But there's one thing for sure. We sure as hell can wrestle, and we wrestle better than anybody else in the world. And when you can get two people that can beat us or even come close, you really are doing something. I'd suggest to everybody, you search. Take a look in the Richmond, Virginias or the Columbus, Ohio's. In fact, when I think about that particular town, Columbus, Ohio, you better be looking very close, because you might be seeing us real soon. Maybe in another couple of hours you might be seeing us. But wherever, find somebody that's even half as good as we are, and we'll be happy. We're the World Tag Team Champions, the best there is, and there ain't none better. And we're going to show you right now why we are.
There you have it, the comments from Ole and Gene Anderson, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. They are indeed the World Tag Team Champions. Right now they're going up against Rick Thor and George Wells, and this should promise to be quite a test indeed for both of these men. Now, the Andersons, of course, from the Golden Gopher State of Minnesota, George Wells out of California, teamed up with Rick Thor. One fall, 10-minute time limit in this Australian Tag Team match, and that is Gene Anderson moving out first very quickly. Started to make the tag and then moves back against George Wells. And now the tag is made. And this is the thing about the Anderson brothers. They have those quick tag in and tag outs and do it so very effectively. Back into the far turnbuckle now. Ole Anderson. Kept his man tied up. Ole Anderson driving a knee to the midsection, then a forearm to the back of the head of George Wells, a snap mare that takes Wells to the canvas. The tag is made. Gene Anderson tags up. And so now they have started their usual strategy, and that's keep their opponent tied up in their corner. They will keep him from tagging just as long as it is humanly possible. And some quick double teaming here, but the tag was made once again. And it's no wonder that they are the World Tag Team Champions with the tremendous skill they have, the great ability of keeping themselves ready and keeping their opponent away from their own corner. Wells has had no opportunity to get over and tag up. Now Wells breaks it up, but Ole Anderson in there on top of him very quickly. Anderson, a hip lock takedown, or a hip toss, rather. Wells powers out once again. And George Wells, red trunks, trying to get back to his feet, makes it back to his feet. Rick Thor waiting in that corner, waiting to tag. Wells with a forearm, another one, and another, and another. Wells back over there, makes the tag with Rick Thor. Thor moves into the ring. You know, the Andersons, Ole Anderson made the comment that they're not very fancy. Let me just tell you something. If you watch them carefully, and that, again, is part of a smoke screen that Anderson will put out so that his opponents may pick up that information. They are one of the smoothest, most professional tag teams that you will ever see. These men are doubly, doubly dangerous. But they use psychological warfare as well as a tremendous skill and ability in the ring. And you'll note that Anderson, both of them, have utilized a great series of holds. Now, variation of the armbar into a quarter Nelson. Now the flat of the foot into the bottom of the rib cage. Tag is made. Gene Anderson moves back into the ring. Gene Anderson, snapmare on Thor, back to the canvas. Ole Anderson. Drove that knee into the shoulder of Thor, and that, of course, they will generally concentrate on an arm or shoulder. Has him, had that arm barred, put tremendous back pressure on the arm. Thor was unable to fight off the pain that was coursing through his body, very quickly conceded, and so the Minnesota Wrecking Crew, the World Tag Team Champions, emerge again victorious in their Australian Tag Team match. Well, of course, there's great wrestling happening all over the country. And right now, let's take a look and a listen to Freddie Miller. Freddie?
Great wrestling action coming up on the 7th, Gaston, Alabama, the Coliseum. The 6th of November, Clayton, Georgia, the old high school gym. On the 5th, Waycross, the city auditorium. Next Saturday, a week from tonight, Halloween Spectacular in Marietta, the Cobb Civic Center. All kids, 11 and under, in costume, admitted free, when accompanied by an adult. Next Friday, Gainesville, Georgia, the Georgia Mountain Center. Next Thursday, Winder, Georgia, the National Guard Armory. Wednesday, Columbus, Georgia. Tuesday, Center, Alabama, the high school gym. Monday night, Augusta's Bell Auditorium, 8:15. Tomorrow evening, a biggie. Columbus, Ohio, 7:30. Tickets on sale at noon tomorrow at the Ohio Center. And remember, great seats have been held back for you out-of-towners. Rich will be there, Flair, Hayes, and Gordy tomorrow night. Tomorrow afternoon, 2 o'clock, Huntington, West Virginia. Tickets on sale tomorrow morning at 10 at the box office at the Field House. Tonight in Chattanooga. Tonight in Piedmont, Alabama. And here's the full card for the Omni a week from tomorrow, November 1st. Next Sunday night, November 1st, 8 o'clock, the Omni. Such stars as Michael Hayes, Brian St. John, Terry Gordy, Bruno Sammartino Jr. for the World's Heavyweight Championship. No disqualification, two referees. Ric Flair against Dusty Rhodes. Special challenge, Tor Kamata and a mystery partner against Wildfire Tommy Rich and Stan the Man Hansen. Dick Slater against Ray Stevens. Steve-O against the great Kabuki. Austin Idol against Mr. Wrestling 2. Good seats now available. That's next Sunday night, the Omni.
The true personification of wrestling greatness has to be embodied within the form of the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. We're going to hear right now some comments from the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair, regarding, his general well-being and upcoming title events.
You know, they tell me that all over the country now, they're having a problem in the classroom. Because every male student has all of a sudden changed his course of thinking. The teachers say, what do you want to be when you get out of school? And for those that are physically fit enough to answer, they say, I want to be like Ric Flair. I want to be the world champion. I want to wear the finest clothes money can buy and the prettiest jewelry. I want to ride in the biggest cars, and I want to date the finest women alive. Oh, I want to be like Ric Flair so bad. I want to hold that 10 pounds of gold. I want to be the champion. Well, there's only one Ric Flair. I hate to disappoint all of you out there. There's only one Ric Flair. Learn to love it. Learn to believe it. Because that's the way it is. In Atlanta, Georgia. Dusty Rhodes, you know how embarrassing it is for me, one of the most gorgeous human beings on the face of this earth, to stand out here? The tape on my head stitches underneath as a result of something you've done to me. Now you think about this long and hard, Rhodes. You may have been a world champion twice, and you may be the idol of all Atlanta, but brother, you are not the world champion now I am. And I command the respect. And this time, my friend, I won't take you as lightly as I did. We're going to be in that Omni again, brother. And you're going to answer to me. You're going to answer to me as no other wrestler ever has. Ric Flair, the living legend. Ric Flair, the world champion. Your world champion. And in the Omni, brother, I'm going to take it to you. Until you look me in the eye and say, Flair, I've had enough. I'm sorry I tried. Woo!
National Heavyweight Champion Tommy Wildfire Rich going up against Don Gilbert. Tommy Wildfire Rich in the green and black trunks. A very quick arm drag takedown. Had Gilbert in the blue trunks off his feet. Another arm drag takedown by Tommy Rich. He goes in deep on those arm drags. Very carefully, collar and elbow once again. It's Gilbert this time getting the side headlock on Wildfire Tommy Rich. Hip lock takedown. Rich catches him in a head scissors. Well executed head scissors. Caught him in the hollow of the knee. Gilbert was able to break free, however. Side headlock now by Tommy Wildfire Rich. Referee, George Scott Jr., tolling the count. And it is Rich exploding, coming off the ropes. Had Gilbert rocking and rolling. Drop toehold by Tommy Rich. Beautiful float up and across the body into a lateral position here. Side hooking the head, I might add, into a, well, basically a side chantry. Notice the way he's got the one arm trapped as well. Gilbert coming back to his feet. And Rich very quickly takes him back off his feet, back to the canvas. Now into a rear chin lock. Tommy Wildfire Rich, former world heavyweight wrestling champion, would like very, very much to regain that title. A lot of people shooting after the NWA world champion, Ric Flair. And Flair thus far has proven himself equal to the task. A radical change in lifestyle when the man becomes a world heavyweight champion. The minute he does, he must pick up all of the contractual obligations of the man he defeated for that world heavyweight championship. Gilbert now, forearms to the side of the head of Tommy Wildfire Rich, rocked him. And Rich hanging onto those ropes now, trying to clear some cobwebs as Gilbert, sensing weakness there, tried to close in, but Rich breaks it up. And if you notice Rich looking outside the ring occasionally, out of camera range at this point in time, the great Mephisto and a masked competitor were watching with obviously more than a great deal of interest. Beautiful replay, and it is Gilbert back to the canvas once again. And there you see Mephisto and this masked individual and trying to get a reading on him, but it's a little bit difficult to tell exactly who that might be. He's wearing a star on his mask. Rich now with a full power slam on, full slam rather, on Don Gilbert. Rich, start of a dropkick coming off the ropes. And again, Rich's attention is diverted to outside the ring as Mephisto and this masked man continue to watch with great interest, going into the abdominal stretch and obviously studying that situation very, very carefully. Mephisto and this masked man who now, Gilbert very quickly conceding to the abdominal stretch. And you can see just in the left lower left-hand corner of your screen, there you see it. A very, very big man, very powerful, standing there alongside of Mephisto. I wanted to talk to Tommy Wildfire Rich, but, well, perhaps I'll get that opportunity here in just a moment. Let me remind you very quickly, of course, Nashville Alive tonight. Ralph Emery is your host. Co-host is Porter Wagner. That's tonight, 8:05, following a Georgia Championship Wrestling. Tomorrow night, Bill Tush in Atlantic City, Alive at 9:05. The National Heavyweight Champion is with me right now, Tommy Wildfire Rich, and I could not help but notice as well as you did that Mephisto was out here with somebody studying you very carefully.
Well, Gordon, it seems like, you know, since the superstar laid all this money around, he ain't nowhere in sight. But every time I turn around, it's Kamata, Stevens. You know, I even got word that Flair might be on a little less money getting. But you know, the thing is, don't matter if it's Atlanta, Georgia, Columbus, Ohio, Huntington, West Virginia. And as a matter of fact, we're coming to all them towns. We're going to start in Chattanooga tonight. Because I ain't running no more. I'm going to look at all of you face to face. But I've got my friends, too. Stan Hansen, the bad man, he's back in. You know, so I ain't worried about it. Because they're my friends. Huntington, West Virginia, I'm going to be there.
That's tomorrow afternoon, and of course, tomorrow night, Columbus,
Ohio. Tomorrow night, that's the big one, Gordon. I finally get my chance again. Columbus, Ohio. Ric Flair, last time we was there, he held my foot. This time it ain't going to be that way. We got two referees. Flair, I'm coming after you and that strap, brother, because I'm nationwide now. I'm not just representing the people of Georgia. I've got the national heavyweight title that goes all over the country. So I'm representing the people of Columbus, Ohio, Huntington, West Virginia, anywhere in that area, anywhere I am, I'm representing them people. Flair, I'm coming after you and that heavyweight belt.
And don't forget, wrestling returns to the Omni here in Atlanta November 1st. Steve O has joined me right now, and like every great professional athlete, he continues to try and sharpen and hone his skills. And I know, of course, that you've been undergoing, we've been talking about it for the last couple of weeks, some very, very special training of late that we're going to relate to the people later on.
Well, that's true, Gordon. You know, in professional wrestling, you have a lot of big, strong men. You've got Terry Gordy. You've got a lot of big men up here, Ole Anderson. You have to be able to battle strength against strength in a certain amount of ways. And my strength has always been my wrestling ability, being able to counter hold, move, and come up with a defense and an offense. Well, just to keep myself a little bit more unpredictable, just to keep myself a little bit better in shape, a little bit better prepared, I've come up with a different training regimen. We're going to divulge it in the second hour, but it's something very special to me. I've been working very hard on it.
Well, I might just point out that once again, it increases his versatility tremendously, and he's a great, great athlete, and a lot of great things are coming for him. Right now, though, here's a very, very special word.
Next Sunday night, November 1st, 8 o'clock, The Omni. Such stars as Michael Hayes, Brian St. John, Terry Gordy, Bruno Sammartino Jr. for the World's Heavyweight Championship. No disqualification, two referees. Ric Flair against Dusty Rhodes. Special challenge, Thor Kamata and a mystery partner against Wildfire Tommy Rich and Stan the Man Hansen. Dick Slater against Ray Stevens. Steve-O against the great Kabuki. Austin Idol against Mr. Wrestling 2. Good seats now available. That's next Sunday night, The Omni.
There's the bell. Bruno Sammartino moving out against Jose Medina. Medina from Puerto Rico. Good go-behind heel block and takedown by Sammartino. Sammartino in the purple trunks, circling his man, moves in collar and elbow once again. Sammartino extremely strong. Drops to the canvas, drop to hold, has Medina back to the canvas. Bruno Sammartino Jr. You go up against a man like Medina, You've got to understand, Medina, who has been in the pro ranks now for 4 years, so he's got some background behind him.
Let's go, Jose!
He wrestled in the 187 weight class. I'm referring to Medina once again. And he was all public and all parochial champion in the 187 weight class in 1976 and second place in the heavyweight class in 1975. So Medina has a lot of fine amateur backgrounds. He particularly likes to use the abdominal stretch that we saw so very efficiently applied by Tommy Wildfire Rich, the national heavyweight champion, a few moments ago. Sammartino Jr., of course, who has been wrestling all of his life. The son of the great Bruno Sammartino Sr., who recently more or less retired from active competition. Notice the way Sammartino Jr. tenaciously hung on. And although Medina seemed to have a momentary advantage, it was wiped out by the tenacity of Sammartino Jr. Medina into those ring ropes now, forces a break. Bruno Sammartino has the knee and the arm applying pressure on Medina. Hang in there, Bob Neal and the football scoreboard coming up here very shortly. Sammartino keeps the pressure on Medina. Medina battles his way back to his feet. Back into those ring ropes. Medina catches him on the ropes now. Uses a forearm twice, very effectively a third time. Has Sammartino back into the turnbuckle. Sammartino, who is exceptionally strong. In fact, the matter is, rated as the strongest teenager in the United States at the age of 19, is certainly evidencing some of that great strength now as you see him bring Medina up over his head, press him up into a full slam. Medina back to the canvas. Sammartino Jr. drives a knee into the chest. And Medina having some problems with that arm and with that back. A hip toss by Martino, and now Martino down across the chest again. Using those powerful legs on Medina. Good takedown again. And that one, Medina came down pretty much on the top of the head. That jams the spine, but Medina fires back. And this is the thing about Medina. The years in the amateur ranks and, of course, now 4 years in the pro ranks have made him an extremely gifted, very versatile competitor. Martino Jr. brings him off the ropes. Medina tried to come back down on his feet to upend Sammartino Jr. if he could. Unsuccessful at that particular point. Vertical suplex. A count of three. Bruno Sammartino Jr. victorious over Jose Medina in this one-fall time remaining match. So another fine victory is chalked up by Bruno Sammartino Jr. Let me take a moment right now to talk to the World Tag Team Champions again, the Anderson Brothers, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. Well, as you predicted quite confidently, you dispatched that team in rapid order.
Well, I'll tell you what, anytime you're in against somebody like us, I don't see where anybody can have any choice. But just hopeful that they don't get hurt real bad. And, of course, one of our trademarks was always to make sure when the people got done wrestling us that they were hurt just enough so that they knew that they were in a match with the Anderson Brothers. When I went back there, I happened to see a couple of people that I'd kind of forgotten about. I'm talking about a guy with the long hair, the blonde hair, not Ric Flair, not Tommy Rich. I'm talking about Michael Hayes. Michael's been chasing people around with baby bottles, trying to put them in his mouth. But Michael Hayes, I'd like you to try to do that with the Anderson Brothers, just to see how far you could go. Hey, I see they got big Stan Hansen returning, the big man from Borger, Texas. Well, Stan, I can't wait to see you. Maybe they are going to get some competition. Maybe they are going to find somebody good enough to go against the Anderson Brothers. I see Austin Idol is returning, and I'm glad to see that, because if anybody can take care of wrestling number two and unmask him once and for all, it would be a man like Austin.
Georgia Championship Wrestling, followed by now.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. From North Carolina at 220 pounds, here's Jim Gallagher. From Alabama at 205, Mike Jackson. Their opponents from Chattanooga, Tennessee at 270 pounds, meet Terry Gordy. And from New York City at 245 pounds, Big Jim Duggan. Your referee is Nick Patrick.
An Australian tag team event, and it's Duggan and Gordy, two massive individuals going up against Mike Jackson and Jim Gallagher, and both of these men are speed merchants, so going to be something indeed very interesting to watch. Jackson, at 205, one of the lighter competitors in the profession today, but a good duck under and escape, another good duck under, and Jackson now with a side headlock. But Jackson was ahead of his man all the way into a hip lock takedown by Mike Jackson. Jackson, by the way, not only has been an outstanding competitor all of his life, baseball, basketball, wrestling, done it all, and has great agility, great speed. Hung on that time, has Terry Gordy back to the canvas once again. Jackson closes in, makes the tag with Gallagher. And Gallagher moves into the ring very quickly, gets the side headlock on Terry Gordy. Bear in mind now that Gordy holds a 60 to 65 pound weight advantage on either one of these men. Gordy now hurls Gallagher back to the turnbuckle. Now a snapmare that takes him to the canvas, makes the tag with Big Jim Duggan. Duggan, out of New York, has had a varied and interesting career in athletics. Been an athlete all of his life. Talking about great competitors, of course, even more great international stars are going to be here. And beautiful move by Duggan. Gallagher tried to slip to one side. Duggan clamped down on him and still got him into a full backdrop. As Gallagher tried to slip away from it. He recognized what was happening to him. Good defensive move and an extremely good counter-offensive move by Duggan. Duggan has him up. Vertical souffle has Gallagher in trouble. Some of the other great international stars, of course, one we want to talk about, a fellow who really captured the hearts of millions and millions of wrestling fans here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. I'm referring to the bad man from Borger, Texas, Stan the Man Hansen. And you talk about a tremendously big, rough competitor he is. Another great international star who will be here in the near future would be Austin Idol. And, of course, goes without saying, we've already seen and talked to the World Tag Team Champions, Gene and Ole Anderson, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. Some double teaming there by Duggan and Gordy. It has Gallagher in trouble. Gordy now with a rear chin lock on Gallagher. A lot of new and very innovative things are upcoming here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, and we'll be hearing directly from the president of the National Wrestling Alliance, Mr. Jim Crockett, from Charlotte, North Carolina. We hope to have him here on the program in the very, very near future, and he'll be telling you about some very exciting things, the balance of 1981 and throughout the year of 1982. But by all means, do keep with us here each week on Georgia Championship Wrestling. Gallagher in trouble now, as Duggan and Gordy have moved exceptionally well against Gallagher. Faring better than Gordy was with Mike Jackson. Jackson now reaching out, trying to encourage Gallagher to get over there and tag up with him. Jackson, as I have mentioned before, of course, holds his master's degree from the University of Alabama in Birmingham. A forearm smashed by Duggan. Duggan now the flat of the foot to the side of the head of Gallagher. Gallagher fires to the midsection, but had little or no effect on Duggan. And that time he drove Duggan backwards. He caught him with a foot, and it is Duggan firing back and retaliating very quickly. And Gallagher beaten back to the canvas once again. It is Gallagher in a lot of trouble out there now as Duggan hurdles him into that far turnbuckle. His leg hooked on the ring rope, and Gallagher could be having additional problems now. Duggan now. Caught from behind by Gordy, and the tag had been made. And Gordy and Duggan both getting in some cheap shots there before the count of four. Nick Patrick tolling that count very, very carefully and very quickly. Mike Jackson makes the tag and moves into the ring, and Mike Jackson explodes on Terry Gordy. Mike Jackson off those ropes, leapfrogs over that 270-pounder, caught him with a flying dropkick. This time drives Gordy back with a second flying dropkick, charges it. Ooh, went for a head scissors. Duggan caught him. And it's Jackson slipping away again, and Jackson went to the midsection, somersaults over, makes the tag with Gallagher. Well, when you talk about perpetual motion, that man Jackson has got it. Duggan, massive forearm into Jim Gallagher. Now Duggan drives a knee into the back of the rib cage of Gallagher, has Gallagher in a lot of trouble. Use the neck breaker. Tag is made. Terry Gordy moves in. 270 pounds. At one time a freebird. And it's Gallagher driven into the mat. And Gordy, so tremendously confident, put a knee on his chest. It was all over. The spinal column jammed with that neck breaker. Jackson out there rendering assistance very quickly to Jim Gallagher as Terry Gordy and Big Jim Duggan leave the ring area completely victorious in this match. Certainly no question about that. I'd like to remind you at 8:05 tonight, don't forget Nashville Alive. Ralph Emery and his guest co-host will be Porter Wagner. Tomorrow night, Bill Tush in Atlantic City Alive at 9:05 right now. The national heavyweight champion, Tommy Wildfire Rich, is with me.
Hello, Gordon. You know, I'm not going to come out here and lie and say I'm not scared. You know, because, you know, it's the situation, it's got to where, you know, it's got me. You're looking back and forth over your shoulders. You know, you got Kamata, you got Stevens. The Anderson brothers are back. You know, they're back for a reason. They ain't just here to wrestle. You know, they can come out here and say what they want. And then a while ago, I seen him standing over here, you know. They call him a super destroyer. I don't know who he is. He's about 6'6", 275 pounds, you know, and that fits a superstar's description to me, Gordon.
Well, you know, it does, Tommy, and that's an excellent point, because I think immediately everybody here in the sports arena looked at this man and wondered immediately. I would like to point out that Mephisto has filed an affidavit with Georgia Championship Wrestling stating unequivocally that it is not the superstar. So, I just don't know at this point.
Well, Gordon, you know, the only difference to me, you know, the outfit. That's all it looked like it changed to me was the outfit. He had, you know, he had a big star over here.
He did.
All he had, you know. But to me, it looked just like the guy.
Well, there was a marked similarity, no question about talking about big fellows. So I know one man that has to come to your mind that you must be very pleased about when you're talking about people that are close to you and will compete with you as tag team partners. You've got fellows like Mike Hayes, wrestling too, and, of course, the bad man from Borger, Texas, Stan Enson.
Well, you know, that's exactly right, Gordon. You know, I said I was a little scared. I didn't say I was quitting. You know, I called right. Stan Hansen. He's a very good friend of mine, and he's been doing a lot of traveling. I told him I had a problem, and he said, if there's anything I can do, you tell me. So the bad man's going to be here.
Well, I'll tell you one thing about Stan Hansen. As I said earlier, you talk about big, rough, and rugged. He would certainly match up with a superstar, super destroyer, or anybody else that you might want to name. And, of course, that would have to include Tor Kamata and Mephisto and Ray Stevens.
And you know the thing about him, Gordon, he'd just soon fight out in the streets as he had inside a building. So it don't matter. Mephisto, Kamata, you want your money, you come get it, because I'm right here, brother.
You know, so many times you can catch moments of greatness in a competitor early on in his career. And we're going to go back now before Ric Flair became the world heavyweight champion and take a look at this man in action, and you'll see now why he is the world champion.
Well, this event is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first from Fort Worth, Texas, at 260 pounds, Rick Harris. Harris. His opponent from Charlotte, North Carolina, at 241 pounds, Ric Flair, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Okay, Harris going up against Ric Flair. Ric Flair, of course, the number one contender for the World Heavyweight Championship, followed so very, very closely that you could almost say it's a dual contention would be Tommy Wildfire Rich. Flair, outstanding competitor, tremendous physical condition, locks up collar and elbow, bulls Harris back to the turnbuckle. And Flair, a total picture of self-confidence. And as you can see, Flair very quickly moves in and dominates virtually every match that he's in. Harris hurtled from the ring by Ric Flair. And it is Harris outside the ring, caught by Flair. Flair again using the back of the... Harris caught him coming in. But Flair retaliates very quickly. Flair snapmares him back into the ring. Flair takes him off the ropes, catches him with the back of the elbow. Harris coming up rather slowly, and Flair again closes in. And here's the thing, Flair will take every shortcut available to him. Flair again back on his feet. Harris fires to the midsection, one to the heart, another one to the midsection. And a forearm, but Flair took them all and came back for more. Full body slam by Flair. And it is Flair again using that elbow. Now using the forearm. And this man is doubly effective. Arm whips him off the ropes. Catches him a high, high backdrop. And Harris is going to have problems in that lumbar region now. And again, you hear Flair saying, tell him that name, tell him that name. He has a massive ego. Certainly no question about that. Flair brings him up. Vertical suplex. From a reverse Nelson, it is Flair. Steps into the figure four. And it is on the reverse side. It is on the reverse side. And that is most interesting indeed, that he goes to a reverse side figure four. And instead of going normally to the right side, goes to the left side. There you have it, of course. Ric Flair is now the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. And a lot of people challenging him for that title. There's certainly no question about it. Right now, let's take a look at wrestling all around the country. And here's our good friend, Freddie Miller.
Next Sunday night, November 1st, 8 o'clock, the Omni. Such stars as Michael Hayes, Brian St. John, Terry Gordy, Bruno Sammartino Jr. for the World Heavyweight Championship. No disqualification, two referees. Ric Flair against Dusty Rhodes. Special challenge, Thor, Kamata, and a mystery partner against Wildfire Tommy Rich and Stan the Man Hansen. Dick Slater against Ray Stevens. Steve-O against the Great Kabuki. Austin Idol against Mr. Wrestling 2. Good seats now available. That's next Sunday night, the Omni.
A few moments ago, we saw Ric Flair in action before he became World Heavyweight Champion. Right now, we're going to listen to the change in this man after he has become the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. Here's Ric Flair.
You know, they tell me that all over the country now, they're having a problem in the classroom. Because every male student has all of a sudden changed his course of thinking. The teachers say, what do you want to be when you get out of school? And for those that are physically fit enough to answer, they say, I want to be like Ric Flair. I want to be the world champion. I want to wear the finest clothes money can buy and the prettiest jewelry. I want to ride in the biggest cars, and I want to date the finest women alive. Oh, I want to be like Ric Flair so bad. I want to hold that 10 pounds of gold. I want to be the champion. Well, there's only one Ric Flair. I hate to disappoint all of you out there. There's only one Ric Flair. Learn to love it. Learn to believe it. Because that's the way it is. Atlanta, Georgia. Dusty Rhodes, you know how embarrassing it is for me, one of the most gorgeous human beings on the face of this earth, to stand out here? Tape on my head, stitches underneath, as a result of something you've done to me? Now you think about this long and hard, Rhodes. You may have been a world champion twice, and you may be the idol of all Atlanta, but brother, you are not the world champion, now I am, and I command the respect. And this time, my friend, I won't take you as lightly as I did. We're going to be in that Omni again, brother, and you're going to answer to me. You're going to answer to me as no other wrestler ever has. Ric Flair, the living legend. Ric Flair, the world champion, your world champion. And in the Omni, brother, I'm going to take it to you. Until you look me in the eye and say, Flair, I've had enough. I'm sorry I tried. Woo!
Yay! Okay, waiting now for Ray Stevens to, and now he is approaching the ring. Ray Stevens going up against Rick Benefield. One fall, 10-minute time limit. And Stevens in the purple trunks very quickly pulls it back into the ropes and explodes with forearms. Stevens drives that knee to the midsection as Benefield to the canvas. Benefield, whose birthplace was Salisbury, North Carolina, very much into weightlifting, hunting, wrestling. He enjoys employing the figure four when he can. We're referring, of course, to Benefield. Ray Stevens, of course, one of the great greats in professional wrestling.
Come on, Ray.
Stevens dominating his man at this particular point in time. Stevens has him up. Full body slam. Ray Stevens, of course, typifies some of the great international stars we've been talking about. Again, we might mention Austin Idol returning, Stan Hansen, the Anderson brothers, the World Tag Team Champions, back in action again. Gene Anderson coming back from an injury, has trimmed down and looks to be in, very frankly, the best physical condition I've ever seen him in. Benefield driven from the ring by Ray Stevens. Stevens can do it all. Has wrestled worldwide on a number of tours. Snap mares Benefield back into the ring. Stevens has him up, uses the pile driver most effectively. A count of three. Hooking the far leg after using the pile driver. Ray Stevens very quickly dispatches Rick Benefield and continues his unbroken string of wins here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. He has certainly proven beyond a shadow of a doubt his tremendous capabilities in the ring. Another man that has certainly proven his capabilities in the ring but has been having more than his share of troubles recently with Michael Hayes is with me right now, Mr. Terry Gordy.
Second, Mr. Soley, let's get right to the point. The point is the man who sold me out, the man who stabbed me in the back. That's my main thing right now, and that boy's name is Michael Hayes. And you know, Michael Hayes, you get out here and you tried to embarrass me right here on nationwide TV by coming out and calling me Baby Huey and calling me all these other names. Well, let me tell you something, boy. You done got one whooping in Columbus. You got another one in Augusta. And tonight in Piedmont, Alabama, you're going to get another one, boy. You're going to get a whooping of your life. And tomorrow night, Columbus, Ohio, I'm coming to Columbus, Ohio to cause a little bit of pandemonium. And I'm going to get Michael Hayes for every single thing that he's done to me. Michael Hayes, there's going to be a whole lot of pandemonium tomorrow night, Columbus, Ohio.
At the Ohio Center. An Australian tag team match. The bell has rung. Wrestling 2 and Steve-O going up against the Angel. And Dave Forrester. And Wrestling 2, good arm drag takedown very quickly on the Angel. Now into a side headlock. Good shoulders match. Drops the Angel to the canvas. This time the Angel is set and ready. Caught him with a hip toss, but Wrestling 2 breaks it up. Wrestling 2 closes back in on his man. Now the Angel bulls him back into the turnbuckle. Right hand into the midsection, a shoulder now to the midsection, now a boot to the midsection. So the Angel very obviously goes percussions to the midsection, trying to drive the wind from the lungs of wrestling too. Okay, makes the tag. Big Dave Forrester moves in there, and Forrester is big, burly, and bad. I can tell you that right now. Forrester keeping his man tied up. Information on this man, Forrester. He's been wrestling 5 years and caught in the midsection that time. Went to Tech of Alumnus. And Steve-O has made the tag, and he brings this man up. Better than 270 pounds, around 280 pounds. Steve-O brought him up. Steve-O into the takedown. This man, Forrester, was in football, wrestling, track, softball, and tennis. So he's done it all. Member of the state 3A football championship. He has got it all together. He's originally from North Carolina. Wrestling two with a high knee lift that drives Forrester back into the ring ropes. Wrestling two, maintaining pressure on Forrester. Referee Nick Patrick checking very carefully, watching. Steve-O, tag team partner with Wrestling 2 in this match against Forrester. Now makes the tag with Steve-O. Steve-O, of course, out of Edina, Minnesota. Here's a young man who absorbs knowledge like a sponge. He is just constantly on the go, on the move, and constantly trying to broaden his horizons. From a full Nelson, he's back into a snap mirror, but the tag had been made with the Angel. O may not have been aware of that fact, and the Angel taking full advantage of it. Beautiful move by Steve-O, rolling reverse. A variation of a saddle block. Now Steve-O caught in the base of the skull by the Angel. The Angel, just about as dangerous a competitor as you'd ever want to find, now tags up with Forrester. And Forrester moves out very confidently against Steve-O, even though he's felt the brunt of a full slam by Steve-O. Has him in a front face lock and wrestling two. He'll be looking to make that tag as quickly as Steve-O can make it over to that corner, if in fact he does. Steve-O escapes very nicely through the arm drag and twist, makes the tag. Wrestling two catches Forrester in the deltoid muscles. Wrestling two has Forrester shaking his head. To the ring ropes, and it is wrestling two. Catching the midsection, drops Forrester to one knee again. Steve-O closes in on him, hooks that far leg. Gets a count of three, gets a count of three. Very nicely executed by Steve-O. And so, wrestling two and Steve-O victorious over that combination of Forrester and the Angel. I want to take just a couple of seconds to talk once again to the National Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. I'm referring, of course, to Tommy Wildfire Rich. And you know, a lot of people have mentioned to me, too, that there seems to be that tremendous marked similarity between this man who they are now calling the Super Destroyer and the Superstar.
Well, you know, it certainly is, Gordon. You know, he said he signed a piece of paper that says it ain't him, but I don't know. I'll have to see it to believe it. And, you know, you got it. Just like I said before, there's a whole lot of things going on. You got this Gary Hodder here with Kabuki, and there's a whole lot of things happening, Gordon.
Well, November 1st, a lot of things are going to be happening at the Omni here in Atlanta as Tommy Wildfire Rich and Stan the Man Hansen take on the combination of Thor, Kamata, and a mystery partner managed by the great Mephisto.
You know, and that might be the night we find out if that's the Superstar or the Super Destroyer, because just like I said, I called Stan Hansen, and he said he will be here. He guaranteed it. And he don't run from nobody. He don't back up from nobody. So we're going to meet y'all heads up.
And tonight you go to Chattanooga, right?
Chattanooga tonight. We're going to be in Columbus, Ohio. I got a shot at the World Heavyweight title. Ric Flair, the boy with the golden spoon. You know, he comes out and he talks about he's got all the pretty ladies. He's got this and that. He's got the big cars, the big planes. Well, I don't need the big cars. As far as pretty ladies, there's a lot of pretty Georgia peaches. There's a whole lot of pretty ladies all over the country. You know, as far as for you, Flair, all you need to be done is took down a couple of notches. And in Columbus, Ohio, I just might get the chance.
That's tomorrow night. Don't forget tomorrow afternoon, Huntington.
Rain.
Well, there you hear it. And you can hear the crowd responding to it, too, I might add. The music of the original, the fabulous Freebird, Michael Hayes.
How you doing, Gordon?
Fine, sir. Yourself?
Oh, I'm doing pretty good. Could be better, could be worse. You know, I heard Terry out here spitting off that I stabbed him in the back and I sold him out. Boy, for 4 years, I gave everything I had to help you along, and you come out here and things you've done to me, and you talk about this and that. Let me put it to you simple and sweet. Anywhere we go, be it Piedmont, tomorrow in Huntington, I'm going to check out all the bad mama jammas. But tomorrow night, Columbus, it may not be booked that way, but I guarantee you one thing. I'm going to go out, I'm going to get another bonnet, I'm going to get another bottle, and for those people, Columbus, Ohio, I'm going to knock you out one more time. Knock him flat out on his back. I'm going to take that bonnet one more time, wrap it around them fat jaws, and stick that bottle right down your throat again.
Fantastic. Tomorrow night in Columbus. Hello, I'd like to take a moment right now. We're going to see the great Kabuki in action, and Playboy Gary Hart has joined us here.
I would just like to say that I'm glad that Ted Oates is somebody. I'm glad that Ted Oates is one of the best wrestlers ever produced in Georgia, because it don't make any difference to me if it's the Omni in Atlanta, Georgia, the Reunion Arena in Dallas, Texas, Columbus, Ohio, anywhere. You better be at your best, or the boogeyman is gonna get you if you don't watch out. That's all I got to say.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you very much. Again, the great Kabuki getting set to enter the ring. And again, that mysterious green fog emitting from his mouth. The most unusual situation. He is going up against Ted Oates, and Kabuki facing a double tough test here in Ted Oates. One fall, 10-minute time limit. And let's have our ring announcer at this time.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit from Columbus, Georgia at 237 pounds. Here's Ted Oates. Ted Oates. From Singapore, 244 pounds, managed by Playboy Gary Hart, here's the great Kabuki. The great Kabuki.
And again, that most unusual individual, the great Kabuki. Dangerous, a master of duplicity and deceit. And Ted Oates, well aware of what he's facing. Ted Oates, a brother of Jerry Oates. They are from Columbus, Georgia. They lock up, and an upright takedown very quickly by Ted Oates. And so Oates may have a great deal of respect for this man, Kabuki, but certainly no fear was evidence whatsoever. Oates trying to assimilate the mannerisms, the gestures, and the movements of the great Kabuki. Well, a lot of great action upcoming throughout the balance of this hour and next week here on Georgia Championship. We're going to be watching for a lot of great action, too. Hopefully we'll be seeing such men as Stan the Man Hansen, Austin Idol, the Anderson Brothers, and many, many more. Off the ropes, Stan Oates, Oates catching him very nicely with a good shoulder smash. This time Oates up and over his man. Caught by Kabuki that time. And Kabuki drove a fist down, but Oates ducked out of the way, caught him in a good arm drag takedown. Oates, who's had knee surgery, is totally and completely recovered. Dr. Jim Andrews taking care of that knee. Kabuki catching him with a double thrust into the throat that has Oates in trouble now. And now going to the pressure points. And this is a thing, of course, about so many Asiatic wrestlers. They understand the pressure points. He is a master of gung fu. And there are four variations of that. And again, you see him striking out. results. An old-fashioned American elbow right into the side of the head that drove Kabuki back. Now a forearm drives Kabuki to one knee. And now Kabuki, using those hands again like lethal weapons, using them very effectively. Kabuki. A chop to the top of the head of Ted Oates, and Oates has got some problems now, and again Kabuki going back to those pressure points. And so we've seen variations of the snake and of the dragon thus far in Kung Fu. He has not yet used his feet, which would be the crane variation of Kung Fu. The crowd picking up the chant, "Let's go, Ted, let's go." Very partisan group here. Very obviously waiting to see the native Columbus, Georgia, born Ted Oates, farewell against Kabuki. And Kabuki having more trouble thus far than he's had with any other competitor. Gary Hart walking back and forth, but intense about this match, certainly no question about that. Oates drives an elbow, drives another elbow to the midsection of Kabuki. Kabuki chops to the middle of the spine. Oates again, using those elbows to the chest and to the midsection. A bolo-like forearm that rocks Kabuki, has him hanging on the rope. Oates now drives him to one knee, and so Oates beginning to turn the tide here. Oates catches him again, and Oates, his face a mixture of tempered rage as he now is driven back to the turnbuckle again. You might be able to hear some...